Hi, good evening. Welcome again to the to our third show of the Nightmare program. We're 6 months into our administration, and tonight I have as a guest on the program our new chief of police in the city of Reading, Andreas Dominguez. You want to say hello, Andreas?
Welcome. Thank you. Thank you for having me, sir.
Yeah. You know, there's a lot of questions I want to ask, but the most important thing is the fact that Andreas basically is back home. Andreas is a homegrown person in our city, and he also he's been away for about 40 years, but you were never really away, were you?
No, every opportunity I got to try to participate, then I come back to church, my hometown church, and obviously my parents and my wife's parents are here, so yeah, I frequently quite often and try to keep up with events.
I want to say that you've had a very busy week this week, haven't you?
Yeah, it's been an unusual week. I've talked to all the other police officers and captains, and they were telling me that this was it happened quiet before I got there. I hope I didn't bring the trouble. But I was very pleased with the way the police reacted and the way they took care of the issues. I think we've just about, we've had everyone that was involved arrested and then detained in a short amount of time. So even though it's quite a few major incidents in a short time, they were solved quickly. It was a good performance by the Reading PD.
I had some questions that were asked of me, I guess, as you know, you saw in the newspaper, there were some comments made. I'm finding that more and more because we don't reach our full potential with the police officers, 200 or 211, whatever we're supposed to have. And I believe, what's our force now about, approximately?
We're under 160. We're like, we just had three candidates just join the force. And we have an academy coming up, which we hope to get another 10 or so. But that'll still cut us a little short because we have some people retiring. But in this area, we're like down in 150. We used to, a couple years ago, obviously we were over 200. But the force is strong and they're well trained and they'll do what they have to do.
Okay. What do you think so far from what you've seen? Do you feel that cameras play an important role in our city as far as helping to fight crime?
Like I said, we've had a couple of great working opportunities with a lot of people in the area, the county and the DA's office, and because of our task forces and our working relationship with others, we've been able to receive grants and monies to buy these cameras. And actually, they've been an extreme benefit. I think they've been quite useful and helpful. In the recent shooting, they provided us a picture of the suspect, which we were able to follow up and finally identify the suspect shortly afterwards.
I thought whatever camera was used for the one that was on the bike, it was really a really good close-up of what the person looks like. Clear. The clarity was well.
I mean, the cameras, they keep improving. We keep improving our cameras. But also we get the help from the citizens every once in a while, which always makes a great assistance because the businesses have their own cameras. So we'll use our pictures, and then we'll also ask the businesses if they could help us out a little bit with their cameras. And more often than not, they do. And in some cases, sometimes their pictures are even better than ours because they're right there. They're in the ground. They're closer to the event.
Mm-hmm. Something I think would be very important is, I think we need more and more private citizens, if they can, to install cameras at their homes. And I, as the mayor, am looking at a way that we might be able to help subsidize, not the full price of the camera, but a part of it. And what do you encourage? Do you see that as being something good that we should be doing, that the public should be involved? And what measures would you take as chief to make sure that if they do get cameras and they do install them and something happens, that we keep their position in the city very secret, that they don't get any kinds of repercussions?
Right now, I think the most useful cameras, and if you were going to start off somewhere, I would ask most of the businesses in the area to have their cameras placed first. I think most of them do, and they maybe improve it a little bit. As far as citizens in the corners, yeah, I mean, obviously, it's a lot much better security, and I think the main cause, most people are afraid of their privacy being invaded. They feel that, you know, cameras tend to invade their privacy. Well, I mean, we would only use it in case of an emergency or an investigation, and then we only hold it for a very strict amount of time, and then we take it off the system. So the information that we get from, from cameras, it's not something that we hold forever. We detain it, and if we don't need it after a certain amount of time, it gets erased.
Would you agree, though, that in today's world, especially in the city of Reading, that cameras are very important to us?
Well, yeah. I mean, obviously, we're seeing that more and more, and people, you know, they can't lie about a situation. They investigatively, keeps everybody a lot more honest on both sides. You know, if people have questions about the police officer, if the camera is there and you see it, at least you're able to see what happened. And same thing with the citizens. I mean, and obviously it helps us. It's helped us tremendously with these criminal investigations. Again, I think this one of these last crimes, the citizen's camera had a much better picture than ours, and it was able to identify the suspect.
I know that you're a person that believes in getting out into the neighborhoods, making sure that we have a good rapport with our neighbors and also with the police department. Do you have any type of special training that you're going to provide? Your special training already that allows police to get more involved with the community as opposed to just protecting, getting out there, getting familiar with them? And
There's a lot of little things we can do. I think we'll start with small steps, and then we'll move into more community policing. We have to keep the security of the city has to come first. But with that, without the citizens, how secure are we? We need the citizens' help. The small steps I would take, instead of just patrolling an area, often I see you'll see the police officer drive by. Well, it'd be nice to have the police officer stop the car, get out of the car, and stop by your business, and they are doing that. We'll try to see if we can increase that more, and then in areas where there might be an increase in crime or we've had some issues, we'll try to see if we can have the police officers at least stop by and do some sort of walking up and talking to the management and the people, and once you have that type of police presence, it usually helps deter some of the issues.
I had a question that was asked to me today, or yesterday it was, from the Red Eagle Times, asking me why do you think people, it was a broad question, it was something to the effect of, why do you think people are committing these crimes? And the second part of it, I believe, was how did I feel, and now how do you feel about a shooting right only a half a block up the street from us, on Cedar Street there, so you're in Walnut Streets. My answer to them was, hopefully to give you a lead, and then I'm sure you have a better one than I do. I said that whether we like it or we don't, we basically are reactionary to stuff that takes place, because it's not like the criminals are out there enforcing the law. Those criminals are breaking the law. But we do our best, I think, being reactionary and making sure we have full support from the community and cameras and stuff. I said, but I've noticed in all the years that I was on the bench that when people commit crimes, especially crimes of murder and stuff, that they're like, it's tunnel vision. They're out, they want to do something, they're aiming on something, they're not looking at anything around them. They just want to complete their objective. And that objective is if you're shooting somebody or something like that. And I said, it's pretty hard to, I think if we had 1,000 policemen, it wouldn't matter. If somebody wants to commit a murder, they could commit a murder. I don't know if there's any way that someone, you were in the Secret Service, and I know the FBI used to do it. They can do profiling and give you an idea what kind of a person would commit certain crimes. But in a community where we have so many people that are not known to their neighbors, or we have some communities where neighbors know neighbors and help neighbors, but we also have communities, where neighbors just go out and they go about their own business, and we don't know who's who. So, how do you? I guess what I'm saying to you is that Is there any kind of a plan when you were in the Secret Service or whatever that would, I know we have maps that are set up telling us about crimes, okay, and where crimes are. And I remember as the district judge, they showed us maps of where people, you know, are on probation, where they live, people that are involved in drug trafficking or, you know, high crime areas and stuff like that. But in Reading, it seems to me as though it starts to shift itself, that there's nothing that's really permanent in one particular area and that it can take place someplace else. But how do you feel about, is there anything that you bring to the table that could help us as a city to be prepared? And if that's, you know, for something to take place, or is that something that just is too far out of reach because of the fact that we don't know when it's going to happen or when it, you know, what would take place?
Well, I mean, the sad reality, and I think everyone is aware, is you can't stop crime. It's going to happen. You know, and sometimes it comes in three, four murders in a row. Sometimes it's one in a month or one in a few months. But, you know, if you're making references to the Secret Service and what I bring or what I would do differently, obviously, most of our security aspects are in prevention, intelligence. So you gather as much intelligence as you can before something happens, and then you go forward and try to prevent it. Often, incidents are prevented, you don't even know that you prevented it. Little things like the police officer getting out of the car more often and walking into the store. If a person was walking by and he was thinking of committing a crime, and then the timing just happens to be right, the police officer walks in and walks out, you know, that's going to deter him. We'll never know that happened. But these little things is the things how you increase it. The community helping out, like if something happens, if the community starts making more phone calls and provide us tapes and videos. Today, this morning, the captain advised me that a private citizen brought in some tapes of one of our suspects, and his tape was actually better than the one we had. So we were able to use that tape to identify the suspect and provide, you know, more evidence. So, you know, once you get involved with the community and you get more involved with trying to prevent crime's going to happen. You just have to get your intelligence and try to prevent as much as you can. Be there to help the community when it does happen. And hopefully our officers are continue to be well-trained and have a good response when things do happen, so the citizens don't feel like they're all alone and such a tragic moment that they have no one to go to. So with some good training and good support from everyone, the officers can, you know, improve the view of the whole department and the relationship that we have. And when crimes do happen, they all get stick together and work together to get through it.
Well, thank you. I hate to bring you back to the cameras again, but we had a meeting and you were there with the district attorney the other day, and we discussed or talked about the opportunity of getting more cameras that might be made available by the district attorney's office. Of course, he limited himself to four. And before you came there, the Chamber of Commerce was very involved. They still are. And I think they provided us with seven cameras or something like
eight.
That. Eight cameras?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we made a pledge to the district attorney, if he gives us the cameras, we'll do a checks and balance and try to get some control put on of what happened to those cameras that were donated to us by the Chamber of Commerce through their fundraising efforts. Just by chance, I didn't get a chance to talk to you today about it. Did anybody look to find out where they are? Or do you have any idea?
Yeah, obviously we're looking for them, and half of them, I think some of them were involved in the installation. Some of them were already installed in some areas, but we're now trying to figure out if we installed them all or we have some laying around. there's been a lot of changes here, a lot of management changes, people going back and forth. And some orders have been sort of slowed down and detained until new management came. So now we're back in full process and things are happening and moving forward again. So shortly, we'll have that. I'm sure we'll have a response to that by tomorrow.
Sounds good to me. We need those other four cameras. Have you noticed that in our city that with other agencies and stuff, I noticed that you're going out, you're going to be meeting with all the chiefs of police and stuff from all over the county and other people, and to familiarize yourself with them, but at the same time, they look at us as, you know, being one of the prime police departments, where our training and our training school is very important. And I guess, you know, you're going to be faced with some situations in the police department where we have a lot of them that'll be retiring through a drop program. So we're going to have to start filling those positions and getting ourselves moving. I didn't want to talk tonight about what the idea that you have that will help us in the future. But I feel like it's something that, you know, that comes from us, from the city of Reading and its people, and the opportunities that we might have on what we might be able to accomplish. We do have a meeting coming up tomorrow with the superintendent of schools. And what time is that?
11, I think.
11 o'clock, okay. I without getting into great detail on it, I think I'd like to show that we're trying to look at a program that would help our city with its youth, okay? You know, the old Police Athletic League used mm-hmm. to be set up like that, the PAL, and I'm a product of part of that myself. They used to be on Walnut Street in Reading, in the 800 block. And one thing I liked, they had a boxing program out there. And, you know, one day you can go and get beat up, next day you're the guy beating somebody else up. But I thought that the interaction of the police department with our youth was so important. And you felt like the officer was your friend, and he knew your parents, and or he or she, although when I was younger growing up, I believe just about all the police were men. We do have women on the force now. As a matter of fact, I think you're promoting one, right?
Yeah, well, one of our lieutenants who's been acting as a captain will be promoted shortly.
Okay, so that I believe would be what, the first female captain? I think there was another one.
Yeah, well, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think, or maybe she was a lieutenant or a captain. Valerie Fisher, she used to be on the force. And I know that I believe she was the first female to either become a lieutenant or become a captain or whatever. But I think, you know, my differences on things that I like to see done with previous administrations isn't, and it's good to say this now so that people understand that, is that I think the biggest thing that people in the city of Reading need is they need the respect of not only its government, okay, but of the people who serve to protect the people that are there. But I think it's also vice versa, too, that the people in the city of Reading have to show respect to those who do protect us and show their willingness and their need to, if we want to stop crime in the city, we have to make ourselves more available and more conscious of our surroundings. Was that something that you, did you ever think about maybe here in the city of Reading, we should be offering something that allows, or at least shows people how to be very conscious of their surroundings to see if there's something wrong?
You know, most police departments have some type of community relationships and in which they have they're involved. They go out to the community and join the different council meetings and community meetings that they have and provide them guidance on security procedures and how to be a little more safer. I know we have some people that have done that, and I think we have. It's been because of the low manpower and the fact that we're working on a crime that's been decreased a lot. But hopefully, like as you said, with the people coming in from the academy, with some good, you know, with good officers doing what they do, we could probably hopefully increase that again and continue more relationships with the community. But and again, also the contacts again when the police officers meet the people. You know, a police officer doesn't just enforce the law. He's not just there to be violent or to enforce the laws of city and the state. He's also your first responder. Often he's the first one there. He'll provide first aid. A police officer is not an official social worker, but he's your first person there that might give you the advice. We want to make sure we update them on all the social services that are available, so when people need assistance or something, they'll get it from them. And even just recently, I just spoke with a couple of police officers this afternoon, and they were telling me how they spoke to they had a situation with a juvenile, and they spoke to the juvenile's parents and advised them about some of the clubs and things that we have in this city, and things that the more the kids are occupied in clubs and community things, the less they get involved with the other side. If they have too much free time and they're out there, they just get involved. It just happens. They get involved in criminal activity. They meet the wrong people. So hopefully, with some good advice and some good police example, be an exemplary person, we can be an example to them, and they can emulate us a little bit, and we can they can reflect with us. So that's my hope and desire, that the department will be a hope for some people for a better future.
Would you agree that in the future, more so now than ever, we really have to be in contact with our youth?
More and more. I mean, obviously, the later you wait, the more difficult it is. So you want to start with your youth early. I mean, I was involved in youth groups. Some of mine were religious. I was involved in a boxing club. I was involved with Boy Scouts. So all these things, always keep your mind occupied and thinking about other things. And at the same time, I was interested in law enforcement. So your religious base will help you, guide you in the right way, because you know that the right thing to do. And then your desire is to do well, to perform well in your future. If you got the right guy, I want to be a police officer, I want to do this. If you commit crimes and you get involved in these things, well, you're not going to be a police officer because you got a criminal record. We got to get them early and work with them, keep them busy, keep them going so that they don't make those mistakes. I think most kids make those mistakes starting in the high school age, and then once they get out, the mistakes get worse and worse, and then it gets difficult to provide them assistance. I mean, it's never late, but your choices become, you have more choices if you, stay in a straight and narrow.
How old must you be to be a police officer in Reading? If you know.
I'm not sure. I mean, obviously, I think at this time it's over 21. I thought someone said 23, but at the very least 21.
Okay. So there's great opportunities, and you said that you... is there a school coming up again for the police department?
We have an academy coming up in July 11th. Okay. And obviously we're, I often find that people think that they couldn't make it, or that's not for them. I mean, if you're a good person and you got a good heart and you want to do something for your community, this is where you should be. Try it. Be that person who wants to help, but sometimes you're not in a situation where you can't help. Well, now as a police officer, you can help. You can do something. It's a very honorable career, and I think once you get involved with that, this type of work, it becomes a lifestyle.
With the police department itself, in order to go to the academy, must you take a civil service test ahead of time, or can you just put in an application?
Well, yeah, there's a requirement to take a civil service test, and then once you score on the test, there's some minimal requirements from the test, and once you get past that, they'll do some background check, and basically those are the things. I mean, there'll be physical requirements, background checks, and the civil service test. But with those three things, will get you probably. Once you get past those three things, you're almost there. Just get to the academy and get through.
If a person wants to apply to become a police officer, they fill out an application the same as anyone else?
Yes, I mean, contact the Reading Police Department and talk to someone there. Just contact the general number. They'll guide you where to go. And we'll give you advice. We'll give you how to go forward and step-by-step instructions and how to apply. And hopefully, you'll find a new career and a new future.
How does one pay for this, and how long is the school?
Well, obviously, if you make it through, there's some minor costs in the beginning. I mean, obviously you have to take a physical or something, but you know, we'll get you through the academy. If we hire you, if we bring you on, we want you to be on, we'll get you through the academy. There are people that just take the academy just to have the certificate so that they can, you know, just get the training. But if you're looking for a law career with us in the Reading Police Department, or and we can go through the process, I think that you'll have a, we'll help you out. Financially, we'll find ways to get you in. If you're a good person and you're worthy, we'll get you in.
Do they have to sign a contract or anything if we're paying for it, the people? Do they have to sign a contract for X amount of years if they make it through the academy and join our police force? I'm looking, how do we make up for that money?
Okay. Like I said, I haven't gone through all the procedures. I'm not really sure how they're doing it now. Things have changed a little bit, and you know, every day there's new things. There's a Lieutenant Winters that I speak with over at the academy, and in fact, I'm meeting with him tomorrow, hopefully, and we'll go over some issues, and we'll discuss that, and I'll give you a heads up and all the new procedures and how that's done.
Well, you'll be coming back on the program again as things become more familiar to you, and as the public gets more familiar to who you are. If I can just like step to another section of this. At this point, I want to let the people of the city of Reading know that you will see a lot of different transitions that are taking place in City Hall. We're doing our best to make sure that those transitions are positive, not negative. We don't look at the politics. My administration, or that I should say the people's administration, looks at people. We look in the advancement of people, and we look for people that will work together with each other. And we're little by little, the administration is starting to get those to realize that it's not like we're here on a personal agenda. We have a people's agenda, and we'd like to rebuild an infrastructure in our city. And I believe that we can be better than where we were, and we still have a future ahead of us that with things that are going to be coming and programs that are going to be coming from yourself will make a difference. And maybe by the next time you come back on a show, we'll be able to take a look at what programs you're going to be instituting, okay? And then how they're working at that particular time. But I think that the people of the city of Reading and in all of Berks County are going to be surprised. Surprised in the fact that we really want to make a difference, and we as a government, or as people that represent you in government, want that difference, that it's positive for you, the people of the city of Reading. I know as police officers, we could sit here and we could talk about, not me, but you as a police officer. We could talk about crimes and the issues that are out there. But I think if there was anything I would like to know, and I'm catching you off guard here though, is there any experience that you had in the Secret Service that would be interesting for people like us who never would have contact with people like you, that would be something that you would find that was unique in your career that you were doing before you retired from there? Is there any one thing that you look at that either was exciting or even if you can talk about it, but that would be good for the public and the people to hear? Because we see the world, as you know, on the TV screen, and we see life from beginning to end in a one-hour program, and then we see life as it lingers on in a series of programs, okay? But, and we see the Secret Service, and, you know, we've all seen movies of the President, Air Force One and stuff, and the people that are involved in there. And I'm just always so, it's exciting, and it's something good to see, and it shows the differences in, you know, the organizations and in the security systems and what America has to offer. And you've been there. You've been in the highest branch of government, the Secret Service, as far as I'm concerned, in the federal government, which is up there. And is there anything exciting or any story that you could tell us that, because I know you've been in other countries, you've discussed that with me, and different things that you did, setting different things up. So I'm going to turn to you and just ask you if there's anything that you can think of that you really enjoyed doing as a Secret Service person, as a human being, and also as someone who was very protective of powerful people who really represent our government.
I mean, each one of us in the Secret Service has, you know, either we have similar experience, and then also we have different experiences. One of the nice things about the community, the Secret Service, was that there's so many different people from so many different parts of the country. So you're working with everyone, the personalities. Again, one of the things you miss most when you leave are the personalities that you work with, and that's the number one thing. As far as experience, I mean, there's probably a lot too many to really pinpoint just one. There's been some major events, and as time goes on, you get the experience to manage people and plan events and plan the security of some major events that you see on national TV. And usually, if the event goes nice and quietly and you don't even notice the security, then that's a perfect event. If you rarely see the Secret Service agent and there's not much issue there with security, then that's a good event. We did good security, and you feel real proud of that. There's so many things that you don't realize what you did at the time, but then afterwards, years later, you go, you know, I was a part of that. I did something good. I was very proud of my 28 and a half years there, and I was very fortunate to be able to do so many different things, and I count my blessings every day.
Your roots in Reading are still here, though. And I know that I don't want to get into your personal family life and all that as far as that goes, because the less you talk about that, the less you have to worry, okay, about people that are out there. But I think when you look at Reading now and you've come back, okay, I know you wanted to be the chief, and you basically presented yourself well, and were very persistent about the fact that you wanted to come home and finish up your new career and your old career by doing something in your hometown. What do you see besides law enforcement when you come to Reading? What did it look like when you were here 28 years ago and now you're living here now? What do you remember?
Yeah, I grew up in a very strong Hispanic community. And there's a lot of things about the Hispanic community people don't see. And I think the camaraderie, the family, the togetherness, the tightness of family, that you know, every people have, but our Hispanic community was very religious. We stayed very close. When my mother passed away, there was a huge, huge amount of people that followed up on that and came to see us and called me and take care of my father and made calls to us. So like I said, we have a very strong connection with the community. I have a very strong connection with the Hispanic community here, and I've been very grateful that to all of them for all they've done for me.
I can tell you, a lot of them basically went out of their way to talk to me about you. And the Spanish population has grown tremendously since you were living here. Mm-hmm. And we have a culture that I think that we haven't taken advantage of everything that they have to offer us as a city. And I think as we go, you know, if we start to put the right direction, not to the people of the city of Reading, but to the government, and have the government realize that we're a very diverse community now, and that wherever you go, you have people that like this or they don't like this. But the main thing is we're all here together. Uh-huh. And this city is something that's got a great heritage. It's got great architecture. I know everybody talks about the pagoda, and they see it up there. And I have people coming into my office asking, how did we get this Japanese pagoda? And I guess I ought to read up on it more and find out how it ended up on the top of our hill. But you know what I like? I like the Reading Railroad. And I like the strength of what a locomotive looks like, and the power that it basically brings, and the movement of Reading moving forward, you know. And I want to talk with you in your administration also about, I'd like to see something or patches or something that we make up that shows the Reading Railroad. Even though the Reading Railroad isn't here today, we still have a Reading Railroad, though. Mm-hmm. I saw in the paper the other day that there was a $5 million grant that was given by the federal government to the Reading Railroad slash something else to put some track over a bridge that would connect Berks County and other counties to New York, okay? And in the campaign last year when I was out campaigning, so many people come here from New York. Their ties are in New York, their families are in New York, and their other families still here in Reading. And they always ask me, is there any way we can get a train that will take us to Reading or take us to New York from Reading and vice versa? And what I thought was interesting is that most of the stuff that I talked about in the campaign seems to be coming about. And it just seems to be happening. What is it? Necessity is the mother of invention or something. Well, the necessity of having something like this, it seems as though people are coming together. I would like to share a couple things with you, not being new to Reading, and obviously your father being here paying water bills, I'm sure, okay? We are making great changes there, positive changes. You read in a newspaper, not necessarily in a newspaper, we got a lot of criticism, not from the paper, but from people who write into the paper and stuff, talking about, you know, oh, we're going to destroy the water authority, we're going to do this, the costs are going to go up, people are going to be without jobs. But I just want something, if I could just share with you, if you get calls in your office wondering what's going on, because everybody seems to want to talk to anybody that they can about water. The city of Reading itself is looking at making the water more accessible to people. And to realize that, you know, without water, we can't survive on this earth. And make it more compassionate. You know, a lot of people ask that I always say, don't turn the water off. And I truly mean that, don't turn it off. And the arguments that you may have heard since you've been here about some of the things that I want to do to change things is that they say, well, everybody has to pay for something and people can't just go and not pay their water bills. Well, that was never my intention. My intention has been that we don't turn the water up because it affects more than just the person who owns the property. It affects all the people that live in that property too and their children. And we put together programs that help them to pay their bills, okay? And then if they don't get paid, then we do move ahead and we start to lien properties. And then when we see it's worthwhile, we sell the property. And one board member came to me the other day, fine man, and he was showing me the amount of money they lose when they go to sales, public sales, and where the liens and everything are taken off, and they lose money because the properties don't bring anything. And I was telling him, you know, if we as a city would work different, where if a person can't afford a water bill, we shouldn't be so quick to turn the water off. Number two, we shouldn't be stickering the building and then ordering them to get out of the building. And I explained to him, could you imagine if the building was still occupied, it has a value to it? Most of these buildings that we're selling it, that the Water Authority basically is forcing liens on and having public sales, these buildings are vacant because people have been put out because of their inability to pay. And you know, you have them as low as $100 and you have them higher than that. But when you look at the actual bill, the water bill is actually cheaper than the amount of cost and everything that had been added to it. And I said, all the properties that basically bring nothing are normally vacant, because today, when you placard a building and you tell that it's empty, people who want copper, bathrooms, whatever, they break into the properties and stuff. And this will be something you're faced with. And I remember as a judge, I arraigned a lot of people that were picked up for stealing copper. The only thing I could never understand, how we couldn't solve the problem of where they sell it at. Because they're supposed to keep a record of where it comes in, and a salvage station or whatever you call that, certainly would know if somebody's bringing in cut up copper in 10-inch pieces or whatever, that it came from somewhere. And if they would just stop buying it, we would be in a position where people wouldn't basically want to steal it and break in and do stuff like that. But I guess what I'm trying to say to you is that if a building's occupied, it's worth more, okay? And that I think that we would go to public sales, and I think that mortgage companies would end up paying whatever the water bill is anyway, because they don't want to lose the property itself, and they might work with the people who have the mortgage. And those people who don't have bills to pay or don't have mortgages, I think along the way we can use that asset to help them with us and with our water bills rather than moving people out. I see a lot of things that in the city that I think probably help criminals more than they do help the government, One of them is the plaque guarding of buildings and the removing people from the buildings. And that it's like pinpointing it and say, here, come here. This is an empty property. Nobody's in here. But through my years, I found that people, you know, people live in abandoned buildings. We have a lot of people who are broke and live in abandoned buildings. And somehow or other, they figure out how to turn that water on in the evening, take a shower and stuff, and turn it off in the morning so nobody catches them or whatever's going on. So we really have to take a look at neighborhoods and properties and see how we can get neighbors to get to know their neighbors so that you know whether the neighbor belongs there or not, okay? And when you see people going in and cleaning out a building, should be calling somebody to find out, if, you know, is this the person who owns it or is this somebody who's actually going in and stripping a building? I saw on the news the other day where they showed in the back alley this car caught by camera that was going through. Did you see that?
Yes, I did. Okay.
I believe, if I'm right, have they turned themselves in now?
I'm not sure. As of earlier this afternoon, they hadn't. But I mean, they were. I think they were. They identified them, but the registration that. The registration didn't go back to the house. There was nobody at that house, so we had to locate them. I'm not sure if they located them yet.
But it was a clear picture. When I saw it on TV, it was a clear picture. I didn't get to see much of the news tonight. I just wanted to watch the beginning because of the big drug raid. And I saw that you were there, and I saw that the Reading Police Department and the county were working together, the county sheriff's office, as well as the district attorney's office, I'm imagining. So. It does work. We can all come together, and it does work. I know. I remember when I discussed it with you, and you were interested in coming on board. I think I emphasized that I'm not very territorial. That wherever we can get a helping hand, we do our best to get it. Until we can get ourselves on our feet, that we can hold our own. And you made me excited to the fact that tonight you were telling on TV to the home viewers that. We have a really good police force, and that you're telling us that they know their job, and that it's very professional. And you know, I think people need to hear that, and they need to hear that we're going to be in a position soon or later where we can get ourselves up to our full complement. And I do believe I talked to an organization that is interested in helping us out with police officers and paying for salaries, okay? And there's a lot of organizations that want to help us out with another program that you have in mind that I would like to wait until we talk, you know, to our superintendent of schools too, and then bring that to the public and let them hear your ideas. It's always good to get fresh ideas in our community. Somebody looking from the outside that loves our city can certainly bring in a program that's going to make our city work. Okay, and so I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to as you start to get that program together that you're looking for, and I'm hoping I'm piquing the curiosity of people that are watching tonight, or if they're not, when they see the reruns and stuff, they'll wonder what is it. And but by then you'll have your program in place and it'll be going. One of the most difficult things about being on TV is you find yourself in a position where you have a million things that are on your mind. I never write nothing down, okay? And if I'm going to make a comment or do a speech on something, I like to just tell you what's going on. But then I get a little trapped when I'm trying to talk to something that would be very specific of where you are and what you're doing. So I'm relying a lot on any conversation you might have that you would like to share with us. Is there anything going on, or how was your day in City Hall? How'd you enjoy it? And what did you think when you walked around there?
You know what? Obviously, when I first started City Hall, it was half of that. You guys built that whole back section, most of the police officers that I knew, they're all retired. Half of them are working still. You know, have their second retirement job in Berks County. But it's a beautiful building, and they did a nice renovation on it. I was really pleased to see that. I also today, last week, I've been spending time walking around, talking to different people, trying to figure out the different where all the different departments are. and getting to, you know, find out how, you know, their opinions about what they do and what's going on. One of the nicest things is that every time I step out for lunch or something, I run into people all the time asking me questions, and they recognize me or something, or and you know, they talk to me about certain things. There have been some complaints, you know, and I do take them in. I do question, and I do follow it up. I've been talking to the captains, and we're going to go through some changes in the police department. There's going to be some promotions, and it's going to be some bidding, and we'll have some new blood. So as the new blood comes in, and we provide, you know, we're going to have a lot of new patrolmen. If the people in the city haven't noticed, a lot of our patrolmen are very young. That's a good thing. I mean, in some ways it's bad, but I'm always thinking the glass is half full. So we got people that we can train, we can guide in the right way. They'll get to know the community better, and you know, say hi to the guy. If there's an officer near you or you see him nearby, be nice, say hi. You know, nine times out of ten they'll turn around and say hi back to you. They're human beings. They got a heart, and they love the city, and they respect their job. I'm very happy with this job. I can't believe I had this opportunity. So I look forward every day to see what I can do. Every day I see more and more people that want to cooperate, people that want to work with us, people that want to work with the Reading Police Department, people that want to help us, people that want to help the community. And it's a very positive thing, very positive.
You know, one big thing that I forgot, when we met with the district attorney, we also had the director of the parking authority with.
Yes.
And one of the things I've done in my campaign, and I'm not sure how you feel about it, is I don't see locking people up for victimless crimes, okay? And that there has to be another way. But we talked with the district attorney about, and you were there, about changing the parking tickets from being criminal tickets to civil tickets. And it looks like something we're starting to move with now. And the district attorney seems very upfront, thinks that it's a great idea, and he, like I believe, that, you know, we shouldn't have debtor prisons. They were outlawed many years ago, and that people who aren't committing crimes against others or victimless crimes, they shouldn't be locked up in jail, and we should figure out another way that it can be done. And we're starting to look into a program of doing the civil tickets, and I'm hoping in the next 60 days we'll have civil tickets. But I had a discussion with you on the possibilities of the police department also becoming more administrative in the parking authority, much like they did in Easton, like they do in Pittsburgh now, where the police department's in charge of the PEOs, which are the parking enforcement officers. And we have a lot of good parking enforcement officers. If we do get together, is this something that you would also be in agreement with, that maybe we take it over and give more control to the police department? But I would like to see the PEOs, the officers that work there now, become part of our police department. Even, I don't know exactly, they wouldn't be policemen, but you know, years ago they had meter personnel. When I was a kid, they were meter maids. Mm-hmm. It was always women that were working on them. But it is something we're going to be looking at. And we're not just looking to get income coming from parking. I think what we're doing is trying to provide good parking, secure parking, keep traffic moving, and making it available in our downtown area. And the last program I had on, Ray Encarnacion, who's the executive director there, is looking at also doing permit parking through the city. And we're also looking at taking and drawing lines so that people basically park properly. We lose a lot of parking spaces by people who park this way. I mean, it might be back to back. Then you always have that one that'll come and won't park back to back, and they're eating up two parking spaces, maybe three. So we're looking at it like that. What did you think of that conversation when we were having it? Do you see that as something that's not only, it's a more humane way to do things, and I think that it will be something that will be better run if we run it through the Reading Police Department, and maybe including towing too, I don't know. But I'd like you to give some thoughts to it, and if you don't have something on your mind right now or or any vision on it. It is something, because your plate's going to be full, okay? Your next 4 years that you're here, you're going to be structuring the police department and making its future by your thumbprint. And that thumbprint's going to be a good one, I'm sure, and be a lot to offer. But did you feel anything in that conversation that we were having with the district attorney on the parking? Have you ever thought about it? Have you ever known anybody that's been arrested that you know personally or heard about that, you know, ended up going to jail for parking tickets? When I say that to people in other cities, they go, they can't believe it, okay?
Well, I mean, I've seen it get out of hand where, you know, kids, they don't mean to be forgetful. But often they'll get a ticket and they keep postponing it, or they say, well, I'll take care of it later. And they put it in their drawer. And next thing you know, it's double the fine. And then they put it in a drawer, it's triple the fine. And next thing you know, they got to get a constable to go get them. And that's more costs and more money. Like you said, it just gets, sometimes it does get out of hand and there's no intent there. You know, that's, unfortunately, that's something the city council and you guys will have to work out. I mean, we'll enforce and work with the regulations and however you put them out. But, yeah, I mean, I have a personal view of that. I mean, as a citizen living in the city and having family that lives in the city, I mean, there's a limit to what you think is fair. So, you know, not being the chief, just being a regular citizen, yeah, I mean, I want the things to be fair, and you know, parking tickets are fines. You got to pay your fine. Okay, you get a bigger fine, you got to pay your fine. You don't see it as a kind of act that you would end up in prison for.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How many minutes do we have left? I missed the sign when you picked it up. 1 minute. I'm going to give a roundup here to our new chief. I'm on the second Thursday of every month. Next Thursday, in July, I won't be on because I'll be on vacation at that particular time. But is there something you'd like to say to the public before we go off the air, Chief?
Thank you for having me. It's been a privilege to serve you, and it will be a privilege to serve you for the next couple of years. Y para toda la gente en hispano en la ciudad, te digo que es un gran honor ser tu jefe, trabajar en esta ciudad. Muchas gracias por tenerme a mí con ustedes. Gracias.
That was good. Maybe I'll have you on here for interpretations too at the same time. Again, we're on the second Thursday of each month. In July, we won't be on. They'll probably, I'm not exactly sure what they do here at the studio, but they might rerun another program that we had. But when we come back in August, we'll have on with us our new city manager, and we'll be able to talk about things and programs that will be instituted through his administration while he's here. I want to thank everybody that allowed us to come into their homes tonight. And I would ask you at any time, if you need any help from City Hall, I'm on my office every Monday morning is on the first floor. I thank you, and I have to say goodbye. Take care. Thank you.